your half-assed reporter, James Kalm, the guy on the bike. And we are back here in Bushwick for, I don't know what it is, the 11th or the 12th iteration of the Bushwick Open Studios. I'm gonna start out in here at the 56 Bogart Street building. You know, there are a lot of galleries here that we visit on a regular basis, but we're gonna go up and visit the Inner Sanctum and check out some studios here. Well, this is Andrew Fish's gallery. Congratulations, Andrew.
Thank you.
We're just talking about how this used to be the space for Momenta art for, I don't know, 7 or 8 years. And, well, nice space, great for a studio. Andrew also does monoprints. We'll take a closer look at some of the pieces. It's got a little, some kind of stencils. Maybe this makes me think of some of the stuff that Archie Rand was doing at a show we saw. And Andrew does kind of realism with landscapes, and then he's got kind of abstract expressionist brushwork that he's fills in. Okay, so I like the way that he's kind of massing out his forms and then using kind of abstract accidental patterning to come in and cut into parts of this. Nice chunky paints. So we've got some balustrades on the side of a river that could be the Thames or the Seine. And then the sky is just swooping brush strokes. I don't have the titles or the dimensions. I would say this looks like it's about 42 by 38, something like that. 40 by 44 or something. Okay, somehow this makes me think of Dumbo. And we've got a lot of raw linen. Okay, so that's Andrew Fish. Well, as I said, I've been covering this event for, I don't know, 11 or 12 years. Two doors on the second floor. Take a step in.
At the Sipuk Wong.
Yes. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Okay, well, there's a lot of people packed in here. I can't get a chance to see a lot of this stuff. We'll get what we can. He does a nice job of rendering these. I guess I'd call them portraits. Female heads.
Is
nice spread. He's building a nice structure of cheese. This festival has gone through a lot of changes recently. Used to be in the spring or early summer, around the beginning of May. This is by Mike Schreiber, Polaroids from Cuba, 2017. Who did the multi-panel piece here?
Oh, that's my friend Chris. He just
What's Chris's last name?
Oh, Chris Rutger.
Chris Rutger, okay.
R-U-C-K-E-R.
R-U-C-K-E-R, all right, thank you. On particle board. Okay. This is the dog boy. Ugo Schreiledig. Okay, so these pieces look like assemblage, collage. Like this. Oh, that's fun. Okay, well, I'm always a little suspicious of someone whose workshop is this well organized. And Ugo's got a real little factory going here. It is a Sweet 219 Art Guerrera Saren Mori. Well, we've been visiting art here for years. And I think Sarah is one of his close friends. Art is a paint maker, and he specifically makes acrylics and various forms of plastic resins. This works by Sarah. Lots of stuff squirted out here. She's got very almost realistic, something you would see in a panorama at a natural history museum, and this looks like octopus tentacles. also be curious about how much something like this weighs. A lot. Oh, I like this triptych. It's kind of dark. It's like caviar and rose vines. Okay, all of these monochromes would be by this guy, Art Guerrera. Recent work, he's got interesting materials like ground up tires and glass pellets that have various types of coating and pigment and finishes. Something like this, if you just see it from about 12 or 15 feet away, it just looks like a monochrome. And then as you come in for a little closer scrutiny, you see that this is actually maybe 3/4 of an inch thick with layers of these glass balls. As you can see, some of them are clear, some of them are opaque, some of them are pearlescent. Okay, yeah. That's pretty flashy too. Hello. So that was Art Guerrera and Saren Morey. Howdy. Hey, Mark is glitterous. And is this Mrs. Glitterous?
This is Mrs. Marina Ryder, Studio 26 Lower East Side Gallery in the house, visiting Bushwick Studios.
Okay. All right. Yes. Tell me the name of your website, and you do videos as well. You want to give us a shout out?
I'm a big fan of Mr. Monk's videos, aka, you know, my same Mr. James Cohen in the house, right?
Tell us about your stuff. Where can we see it?
My stuff is a little bit like yours, where I like to take the moments of the creativity, the energy that's running around us, and then I like to put a little music in there as well. And
you
like
put a lot of glitterous,
you know,
in there?
Well, yeah, I do a little day glow there. You know, Kenny Sharp, I'm a big fan of, as you're familiar
with.
Kenny Sharp.
I knew him since he was a little kid.
Wow. I'm a fan of Mr. Monk's work, too.
Okay,
so.
All right.
It's good to meet you.
Thanks, the glitterous awesome couple.
Yeah, cute.
Okay, suite 230. This artist's name. So if you listen closely, you can hear him discussing his work and his inspirations in the background. I like the painting table. Can you tell me what the artist's name is?
Zhu Yujin and Foster Mickey.
What was that again?
This is Zhu Yujin.
Hi.
Zhuji?
Yeah.
And I'm Foster Mickey.
Foster, and what's your last name, Foster?
Mickley, M-I-C-K-L-E-Y.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
All right, so... Okay. Photography is dead. Jonathan Quinn. Looks like Jonathan is kind of a conceptual painter and be a sculptor. Yeah. Oh, but there is some photography here. You're Mr. Quinn?
How are you? Very good to see you.
Okay, give us your little explanation here.
All right, so this shape here is an anemone. It's on the side, if you look on the side of a globe, you'll see it. And it represents 1 year of the Earth traversing the sun. The top would be the summer solstice, winter solstice, and the two equinoxes.
Okay, so you've got a couple of different versions there. I got a question for you. Why is the bottom end of that elongated like that?
Artistic license. I decided to...
You're changing the cosmos just because you're an artist, okay.
Well, I can make the argument that you're traveling from Miami to Toronto over the course of the year.
Uh-huh.
There was a decision made to... It's not a stationary anomaly. It's a...
Okay.
It's a template for nine planets.
So we got Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune, Earth, Mars, Venus, and Pluto, I guess would be the little one, although that probably is out of proportion. Or is it? Are these exact proportions?
Well, they're it's what you would call
artistic
it,
license
it's
you, again.
Yeah, it's what you would call a composite illustration.
Okay.
It's
okay.
In order to take up the amount of room in that amount of space. But you could argue that that would be the size of the planets at a given distance.
Okay.
A given distance, it would not be the same relative to each other, but it becomes an aesthetic.
Okay, thanks for the explanation.
Actually, this one is also kind of fun, too.
Okay. A tuning fork in its three most extreme states. Something tells me that those tuning forks don't make real high-pitched noises.
It's a three-dimensional representation of a photograph.
Okay.
Three photographs.
But this actual piece, this is made out of oak?
Red oak.
Is that red oak?
Yes.
Beautiful. Okay. Well, thanks, Mr. Quinn.
Thank you.
Okay, I don't know how much we're gonna do of this, and I'll probably come back tomorrow and I'll paste this all together. Yeah, people ask me about my butchering people's names when you see something like this. Levan Mindeshivalvivili. Mindeshivalvivili. Okay, so I've got some drawings on drafting vellum. This looks like some kind of a transfer. Levan Mendishvili. I kind of like this unstretched piece. Looks like a blackboard. I'm not big on algebra, so I don't know whether that
formula means anything. Okay. Some maps. Okay. Congratulations, Levon. Okay, so they're doing a little pop-up show here called Last Drop of Summer. Now, I've been in this studio before, and it's always fun. You got lots of fluorescent color. Take a run through the show. Well, that's kind of juicy. Okay, I don't have any wall labels, so I don't know who this is by, but I like the effort, punchy palette. This makes me think of an artist named Philip Evergood. Interesting. Okay. Now, I was looking at these pieces with the fluorescent paint and the slats, and I like the way that the light reflects off the wall. It's very apparent with this one, the way the fluorescent colors kind of distort your sense of the surrounding colors. Cordy Ryman has been doing work that kind of relates to this for the last 8 or 10 years. Oh, that's fun. Inner Space, Lena Vido Art. Another version of the Big Eye Girls, with the pouty lips. This is nicely rendered. I love to see the pieces in process.
So of course I have a theme that like from inspired by this like classics, but then I have that going on. And then I have all this visual vocabulary that I play with. So I did this whole series of bondage like 20 years ago. So I put in my
this must be Lena.
And then I just go a little crazy too. So, you know, but this is a woman, but it was because I have a few paintings of men, but I like to paint.
Well, and that's what I wanted to understand is like, obviously, if you're a woman or right, I'm calling to you, like, right, the first is the most important.
Right.
Okay.
Change the game, my style, and the style that I incorporate there in the models was not, they wasn't a guy, it was more of a discussion, it's more proportional.
Well, we're going to head east out to Wyckoff Avenue and see what's happening in the street festival and the drag queen festival. The term open studio is a whole new meaning. Studios, but I thought maybe as we cruise between some of the studio buildings, we'll take a look at some of the development that has been changing this neighborhood. I know everyone is concerned about the question of gentrification, and I started covering this neighborhood back in about 2003, and I've seen incredible changes here. And especially within the last 3 or 4 years, it's just frightening. Okay, 119 Ingraham Street. Studios are located on every floor. Let's start in the basement. Okay. They've got a little set of displays in the hallway here. Yannick Wagner 109. Okay. Hello. Tell me what the name of the artist is.
The artist is Yannick Wagner.
Yannick Wagner, okay.
W-A-G-N-E-R.
And these are all oil paintings? Is that what we're looking at?
All oil, there's two watercolors.
Okay. All right, thank you. All from the last year. Is there a backstory? Are you his agent?
I'm just his wife.
Oh, just his wife. Okay. All right.
He just stepped out to see some other artists work. He'll be back shortly.
Yannick Warner?
Wagner.
Wagner. Yannick Wagner.
Right there on the table.
Okay. All right. Thank you. This is the temporary storage large space. So what did you do with the money? The monetized Negro and the poltergeist of my family story within American history, David B. Frye. Okay. So this is a one-person show by David B. Frye, I guess. And yeah, these pieces look like they are oil or acrylic on wood, and then he's got elements that he's added, a wooden chain. We got a crucified Jesus on the revolvers. Are you David?
Yeah.
Tell us about the show.
The paintings in the show are about the things that the people who own my family bought with their money. My family was enslaved prior to 1789, and we were forced marched from Tarboro, North Carolina to Robinson County, Tennessee, where we became slaves of the Fort family. The Fort family are prominent citizens in the history of Tennessee. They built at least two plantation homes in Tennessee. One was called Happy Cliff and the other was called Meridian Hills. They also, one of their descendants, Joel Battlefort, was a principal shareholder of the Edgefield and Kentucky Railroad. And he also had a son who became the medical director and co-founder of the United Life and Casualty Insurance Company based in Nashville, from which the Grand Ole Opry was also broadcast.
Okay.
The reason for painting these pictures was that a gentleman told me that slavery had no relevance or effect today and that he was tired of black people complaining about slavery. I was determined at that day that I was going to go out and find out exactly what the people that owned my family did with their money, and I was going to have an answer for them about how slavery is relevant to today. If you look at the Edgefield and Kentucky Railroad, today it is owned by CSX. That insurance company he founded is owned by AIG. Slavery is a foundational basis for many large businesses in the United States.
Well, all over the world, wouldn't you say?
And all over the world, exactly.
Europe, Asia?
Exactly.
All over. Tell me a little bit about the paintings now. Can we walk over and look at one of these? These are, is this an oil it's we're looking at? Oil paintings or acrylic?
It's oil and acrylic.
On wood?
On polychrome wood. The chains are individually carved from a single piece of wood.
Right, so you're you're down there with your knife cutting out the links and getting this off. And then each one of them has something a little unique here, kind of like a little fob at the end of the chains here. And this is like an old tea cistern or something here?
Tea or coffee urn. It goes okay. With an office building. That is the office building of that insurance company. It's a representation of that. And it is there that the Grand Ole Opry was first broadcast. So the insurance company actually supported the Grand Ole Opry as a form of advertising. That's the other piece there is the railroad.
Okay.
Kentucky Railroad. One of the interesting things about them is that they sold the train that Jefferson Davis used to escape from the siege of Richmond to the Confederate Army. That's one of the other interesting facts. But they moved tobacco from the large tobacco plantations in western Tennessee to Nashville for distribution to points further out.
Okay, we've got a little spittoon here.
Yes, that's a found object, and I created a replica.
Okay.
Spittoon.
Well,
those pieces are called the Orders of Protection. And
so is this, is that cast?
That's cast Babbitt.
And cast Babbitt.
Babbitt is a tin alloy that's used in the elevator trade and to support bearings on machinery and hoist ropes.
All right.
It's a low temperature alloy.
How long has the show been up, David?
It's been up for around 2.5 weeks now, and it has a couple more weeks left.
Have you been getting people through today?
Fair amount.
Oh, good. All right, congratulations. What was the title of the show again? It's a long title.
It is called So What Did You Do With the Money? And it is about essentially what happened when you monetize people and generational wealth. I think that it's a conceptually driven painting show, and the reason for it is that I'm trying to actually expand on an experience and, you know, kind of like give people a picture of what kind of impacts slavery might have had on individual families economically, and how that money is still at work, and how the resources that they developed as slaves are still in use. You have land being cleared, you have land being developed, you have railroads, you have all sorts of businesses that use this as a foundational basis. And to say today that none of this matters is actually pretty insulting. So,
okay.
I was happy to make the work because I think it made me feel a lot freer from, it freed me up, it freed me.
That's good. That's what art should do. Thanks, David. Thanks for your little explanation too. Okay. Oh, I like the bag. Thomas Bird Dodd.
That's my assistant's work. Isn't it wonderful? Collins.
Is this his
name? Huh? No, he's not.
They have
Tommy
Collins downstairs.
Yeah, he has more work in his studio.
Second name is Ice Spy.
My jars? My mixing jars?
Yeah, my mind.
I mix a lot of paint. But there's a familiar face.
So are these yours?
They are mine.
Okay, tell us about them.
Well, they're oil paintings.
That's what we're looking for, yeah, oil paintings.
I just did this summer. And my practice is based on meditation. And I draw from relationships between human beings, basically. And the more personal that relationship, the easier time I have to draw them.
And what about the pieces down here on paper? Is this
these
acrylic on?
Prints.
Oh, these are digital prints.
These
okay.
are all done on an iPad.
Ah.
An iPad Pro with an Apple stylus.
Is that
specific? It's not. I started with a mini, and I upgraded when the iPad Pro came out.
Apple Pencil as well?
Yeah, I love it. It's fabulous. Which works well with my busy schedule, because
okay.
I run Brooklyn Fireproof as well.
Yes, I do.
And so the iPad is actually a nice way to paint no matter where I am. And in the back, those are acrylic on paper.
How about the color selection? Is that all also coming out of the Apple, or do you have a little more leeway with the colors?
Well, you know, I do use the colors in the computer.
In the program, right?
And then when I paint stuff, so I'll use that as a sort of a study, and then the colors are based on whatever my mood suits me. I'm very hooked on baby blue and baby pink.
We just love those baby colors. Okay, well, someday those colors will grow up, and then you'll have to send them away.
Now I'm into orange, which is,
okay.
A bit of a growing phase. It took me to get to the orange and stuff.
All right, thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for stopping in.
Have a nice weekend.
Enjoy BOS.
Yeah, I am. Okay. We'll keep moving right along here.
Decision, I need some guidance.
Jeez. Hi, Chris. Uh-oh.
painting by Cheryl and Needhart.
Cheryl and Needhart? Is this Las Vegas?
Yes.
Is that the, what is it? The?
She's right around the corner. She can answer. Sherilyn, come talk about your work.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Sherilyn.
Hi.
Nice
to meet you.
Is Lori Monk's doing one of these infamous, famous videos?
Oh, sweet.
So this is out in Las Vegas. Is that correct?
I went to
Caesar's Palace.
I think that's Caesar's Palace.
Is this the fountain in front of it? Well, sort of.
Okay. Yeah. I went to Las Vegas in the springtime with my brother because we wanted to see Cher, and we also went to a Britney Spears concert.
Wow.
And we were like kind of people watching on the Sunset Strip. I took a lot of double exposures, and that was the inspiration.
That's what I was thinking. It kind of looks like it's collaged together, so you've got some larger figures here against other things.
Uh-huh.
That's great. And this is oil on canvas? Is that what
it
is?
It's oil, and actually several of these colors, including the cobalt blue that is the underpainting, that I ground that paint myself.
Good for you.
Yeah. I used to be a painter.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Just for yourself, or were you working for a local paint maker?
No, I had a store on Bedford Avenue called Sarcana Art Materials.
Okay.
At 208 Bedford. It closed in 1999.
So what's your favorite type of oil to grind your oil pigments down into?
I like walnut.
Walnut.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
It's very clear. It doesn't yellow.
But doesn't walnut take a lot longer to dry than regular linseed oil?
It has a little bit more open time, but it's less yellowing.
Okay. All right.
Thank you. Body.
All right. Congratulations.
Thank you so much. I appreciate you coming by.
Thanks for the tips.
Anytime.
Hey, Chris.
Bye, Laura.
Bye-bye. Okay, well, let's see what's across the hall.
Answer.
Oh, I remember coming in here last year.
I know, that's really bad. That's bad. Yeah, I know. Yeah, you're welcome. If you could send me the process, I would.
That's fun. Kind of keep our little extra paint stuff that we scrape away and classify it, categorize it. Okay, I'm going to run out before people come over and start unloading on me. Rebecca Litt. I think we have probably popped into this studio for at least the last 2 or 3 years. Hello, Rebecca. Good, how are you?
Good.
Paintings are looking good. Wow.
It's good to see you out and about again. Have you seen lots again?
A few things. The tadpoles.
Yeah.
I was going to say maybe there's some kind of Freudian meaning thing going on there. Maybe not.
Yeah, maybe. I'm nearing 40. So
what's the story with the new, the swimmers and... the currents?
This one's called Eddies. And all of those little guys are Ed.
All right. We got Crazy Eddie and Fast Eddie and...
Yeah. I've just been playing with pattern in the landscape and obscuring.
And these are oil on canvas? Is that what these are?
The little ones are on board. And the big
on board. Okay. What's the title of this one?
Tadpoles.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
it sounds like there's a flock of bees going on out here. Oh, a drone. That was fun. Well, that'll probably be the way that we'll be doing the Kalm report next season, so enjoy the old low-tech version while you can. For Stewart Avenue. We'll take a peek down this way first. Remerge Studios. Copyright more Gomer tree.
Hello.
Hello.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Are you filming or taking pictures?
I'd never use film.
Okay.
It's all on a little card.
Oh, cool.
Are these your paintings?
Yes, they are. That, well, next door is another person.
Right, but this is yours.
Yep.
What's your name?
Kirsten.
Kirsten, do you have a last name, Kirsten?
Yep, Leach.
Kirsten Leach. And is this oil that we're looking at? Oil paint?
Yeah, it's oil paint.
With some kind of resin in there, or just oil and turp we're mixing up? Or?
Oil, turpentine, and linseed oil. So, are you a painter?
I try.
You try?
Yeah.
Me too. Okay.
Did you just do this today?
No, I did this on, it's all a blur, but I think I did it Tuesday or Wednesday.
Okay.
But I've been working on it. At least I did this layer Tuesday.
Do you use any dryers?
No.
Like a cobalt dryer or any of that stuff?
No, I just let it dry.
Takes a lot of time.
Yeah. I'm into I like having a relationship with paint and just letting it.
Yes, it's a thankless relationship.
Yeah.
You know, and then they never call or send flowers. Right? Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. You can take a card if you'd like. It's right on the
Okay, thanks.
Yeah. Google it and
hello. Wow. And your deco, how do you?
Deco.
Wow. And these are all oil paintings?
No, this tea is oil.
I think that's it.
She makes it. This one is acrylic painting.
And you're working on this one right now.
Yeah, I'm trying to do this one.
Your sketch.
My sketch, yeah.
That's great.
I might change. This morning I had this one, I had that one, so I might change the process.
Right.
Because of the space, I can't use the oil.
Because you'd be breathing in the turpentine fumes and all that stuff.
Yeah,
I understand.
That's why I'm using acrylic.
All right, looks beautiful. Okay, thank you. All right. Well, they pack a lot into each square foot here.
Did she try to collect you?
Hello.
Does he know David?
I don't. You met David, haven't you? Yeah. David was trying to like be one of the contract signers.
Oh,
but without signing the contract.
He's too lawyery for it.
Oh, really? Well, I don't think they would like that very much.
Yeah. Yeah.
Katie Woolley?
Katie, yes.
Katie, is that you?
It is. Hi.
Hello.
That's my most recent one.
Did you do this photograph piece here as well, or is that somebody
else? No, it's a Calvin Klein ad. I just sort of
collage stuff on it. Okay.
Yeah. I was thinking about that there's arms and armor at the Met, like Napoleon's knife or Henry V's shield, and they're all sort of very ornate, like a doily, and very embellished with jewels, and I was into this, like, sort of macho, bedazzled persona.
I thought if you wanted to, we could walk around the building. And
yeah.
Okay. Thanks, Katie.
Oh, thank you.
And Schmidt. Hello.
And it would be, it was about 20 minutes from LaGuardia.
Oh, I saw one of these in the 119 Ingraham Street building. Yeah. It's like scrims. Layered. Oh, some nice little drawings. Tell me your name.
Linda Schmidt.
Linda Schmidt. Okay, that's what I thought. I just want to make sure. Thanks, Linda. This makes me think of Dubuffet's Texturologies. Yeah, I like the way that sort of showing the technical approach in the finished piece. Tell me your name.
Hi, Blake.
Blake.
Yes, Blake Openman.
Okay. And what kind of medium are we looking at here? Is that just plaster or is that?
Cast cement.
What is it?
Cast cement.
Cast cement. Okay.
And so is that with wax?
Beeswax?
Cement and wax, yeah. It's a combination of beeswax and
microcrystalline wax,
yeah,
yes.
It's like very brown and some screw wax as well.
Better get those lights away from there, it's starting to melt.
Yeah, well, could be the intention too, right?
I don't know. As long as you don't start a fire.
Hey. Yes, true.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, you're very welcome.
Oh, we got a little mini gallery in here. Kind of like the way this works out. Blake Holton. It makes me think of a geode. Let's see if we can get in here and see some stuff at 75 Stewart Street. Gee, mommy, it smells like pee-pee in here. Well, I guess we'll save the best for last. We'll run up to the Sky Fort. Okay. Maybe we made it here before closing time.
Hi,
are you guys still open? Okay. I'm a nosy guy. Some large unstretched gestural figuration. Looks like there's some digital printing going on here. Oh, that's big. Kind of like that piece. Thank you. Sky Fortress. This has been James Kalm reporting on Bushwick Open Studios 2017. You can leave your critiques, comments, ideas, suggestions below. Thanks for watching, and as we always say, thank you, Kate.
Everything's an exploration.
Thank you.